as we the second message. Heavenly Father, we just thank you because you brought us here to bless us and to equip us, to challenge us, to make us to be the kind of leaders you want us to be. As we look into this second message, oh God, still on the same issue of unbelief, open our eyes of understanding.
Amen.
Thank you because we know you've answered.
Thank you, Father.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
We're looking at this message, faithlessness in upcoming ministers, and that's very, very deadly. The quality of the spiritual life in a local church or even in the nation will be dependent on the quality of the spiritual life of the ministers who are the guardians of that faith on earth. Show me strong ministers, I'll show you strong congregations. Show me weak ministers, I will show you weak congregations. But when God's kingdom is beset by a generation of budding and oncoming ministers who are unserious, who are unbelieving, who are unconvinced, disaster lies ahead for the church. Disaster looms ahead for the church. When upcoming ministers are people like Gehazi, are people like Judas Iscariot, are people like the sons of Eli, Ophni and Phinehas, when upcoming ministers and growing ministers that are going to take over for the next generation, when they are like the Levite of Bethlehem, Judah, who could, because of salary and because of fringe benefits, agreed to be a priest of idol. Somebody was a priest of God. When these are the people, and like the sons of the prophets we are going to see in this passage, when upcoming ministers are like that, the church is in trouble. Big trouble. The church has no future when you have ministers like that. And unbelief in upcoming ministers or faithlessness in upcoming ministers is already bad. Like I've shown you, the effects of pastoral unbelief, the effects of unbelieving ministers stagger the promise of God. It will shift us from God's purpose. It will make us to slip from God's path. And it will make us to slide from God's protection. But we want to see in this passage, and I want to show you and use it to evaluate your own life. Jesus said when he comes, will he find faith in the earth? Will he find faith in your life? Will he find faith in your community? Will he find faith in the church? Or is he going to be a bundle of faithlessness all around? Faithlessness in the ministers, faithlessness in the church, faithlessness in the congregation, faithlessness in the community. But it starts with the head, like father, like the son, like mother, like the daughter, like the priest, like the people. That's why we are concentrating. If there's going to be faith in a congregation, it starts with the pastor. And if there is unbelief in the pastor, it will spread and infect every member of the congregation. So it's very, very important. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 2 and begin to see the story. 2 Kings chapter 2, you know the story, but we read. And it came to pass when the Lord will take up Elijah, into heaven by a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophets that were at Bethel came forth to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he said, yea, I know it. Hold ye your peace. These are people we can call historians of the church. They can tell you the history of deeper life when we were at Oyinbo and when we were at Yaba, and they know all the story. My brother, what has God been doing in your life? You have been in deeper life for 20 years. You have headache. You have to go for paracetamol. You have had messages of faith and faith and faith and faith. You have not developed enough your faith to be able to even minister healing to yourself. But you know all the story. When we were in Bagada, when we were in Ayobo, when we were in Oyinbo. Just like these sons of the prophets. Any story going on in the community, they know it. Do you know the Lord is going to take away your master from your head today? Elijah said, don't bug me with all those information. I know. Hold your peace. Do you know what he said? Do you see that verse 3? Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master? Elijah was also their master. The sons of the prophets were students in the school of the prophet. Elisha was one. Elisha was a student. They also were students in that school. Only that Elisha was also a personal assistant to Elijah, apart from being a student. But can you see how they refer to Elijah? Do you know the Lord is going to take away thy master from your head? Is he not your master? Already you can see how detached they are. Detached from the source of power. Detached from the place of anointing. Detached from the man of God. He's not our master, he's thy master. You can begin to see the unseriousness. They are in the church. They are studying to be prophets, but their attitude is far from the attitude of prophets. They are studying to take over after Elisha has gone, but their attitude is completely something else. So they told Elisha, and Elisha could see that these ones are unserious. If I join myself to these people, I'm going nowhere. So when they came and they told Elisha, I said, I know it. Hold your peace. Just keep your information to yourself. He was not snubbing them. He was just saying, your seriousness, I don't want it to affect me. Because in all this, that's the only thing you can say. The sons of the prophets in this story, they were Elisha's colleagues. All of them were students in the school of the prophets. They were called sons of the prophet. It's an appellation. It doesn't mean that their fathers were prophets. Sons of the prophets. That was the appellation given to those who were studying in the school of the prophets, ultimately to become prophet. They were called sons of the prophets. Not talking about biological sons. So on the day that Elijah was to depart, like we find there, in the chariot of fire, they repeatedly told Elisha, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? Because look at in verse 3, that's what they told him. Knowest thou the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? Look at verse 5. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? Everywhere they went, those people, they had information. And they were ready to offer anybody who has ears to hear that information. But as they came to Elisha, Elisha always told them, I know it, hold your peace. Don't bug me with that information. Don't waste my time discussing that information. I have something else I'm focusing on. Keep your information to yourself. I know it also, don't worry. You need to give people like that gaps. People who are unserious in the kingdom, they are part of the leadership, but they are unserious. They are part of the church, but you never see them being grave. They are part of the church, but they are never, you know, we want to focus on this assignment and bring glory to God. But they just say, well, we are also deep alive. We are going nowhere, and nobody can do anything to us. Yeah, my brother, nobody can do anything to you, but I'm not going to allow you to infect me with your unseriousness. I'm going on. Going on with passion for God. These were unserious. Sons of the prophets, but unserious. Students in the school of the prophets, but unserious. But they're not only going to be unserious, they want to infect other people. And I'm telling you, you need to do like Elisha. Don't let people, they may be in the leadership, but they are not serious. Don't let them affect you. Don't let them, you know, cool down your, you know, I remember many years ago in the UK, there were people, they were in the leadership. And they used to call me John the Baptist, you know, like a jest. You know, this, that our brother John the Baptist, he has come. Because we are so serious for God. But they are also workers in the kingdom. Oh, but I don't care. Label me. I'm going on for God. There are people like that, still in deeper life, still workers in the kingdom. When they will label some people, say that one is John the Baptist, so don't move near him. Unserious. But I don't allow those kind of people to infect me with their unseriousness. That's why, by the grace of God, I'm still on fire for God up till today. You cut yourself from those kind of people. Cut yourself. I know it. Hold your peace. Retain your information to yourself. Let's discuss it. I don't have time for that discussion. I'm focusing on the double portion. I have better things to do with my time. Not to be discussing God is going to take Elijah away today or not. That's not... I'm not ready for that. Hold your peace. So everywhere Elijah went, they always came to Elisha. Do you know this? But you know one thing? My question is, do they even believe the information they are telling Elisha? They didn't. Somebody said, Pastor, what do you mean? I will show you. That these individuals, they are saying it. The Lord, do you know the Lord is going to take away your master from your head today? But they don't even believe that information. It's just empty religious profession. Somebody said, but Pastor, I will show you from this passage that those people, they don't even believe what they are saying. They don't believe it will happen. But they were telling Elisha. Is that the person you want to move with and you think you will get to the top? You won't. His unbelief will infect you. Do they believe what they were saying themselves? Events show that they didn't believe it. They didn't believe it. And we will see it. In verse 7, 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 7. And 50 men of the sons of the prophets went and stood to view afar off. And they too stood by Jordan. Elisha is standing with Elisha and saying, I'm going to be with you until the very end. I'm going back home only when you have gone in the chariot of fire. But these other sons of the prophets, they are not bothered. The Bible says they stood to view afar off, detached, old. They gave themselves distance. If this fanatic Elisha wants to go with Elijah, it's his choice. But for us, we are here, we are seeing, we are watching. And there are people like that. And they are watching. Say if these people are going to kill themselves. Vimakate, kill themselves. Rokakoga, kill themselves. Every day, money, every day, we have project. Let them kill themselves. There are some people like that, they're going to be looking. Couple, they are not going to offer. They are not ready to do God's work. But you don't allow anybody to influence you. God blesses those who are committed. God is faithful. They are not serious and they don't want any other person to be serious. So you cut them off. Hold your peace. Hold your peace. Don't affect my commitment. I'm focused. I'm going with this man of God. I buy into the vision. I'm going with it. You want to view afar off, that's your choice. But I want to stay close. The sons of the prophets, 50 of them, they stood to view afar off. But Elisha stood close by Elijah. We are going together.
Amen.
You better don't join the group of the unserious. You'll be viewing afar off. On Elijah's last lap, 50 of these sons of the prophets, they stood to view afar off. When Elisha accomplished Elijah as they crossed River Jordan to the airstrip, where the chariot of fire is going to take off, to the tarmac, in readiness for the arrival of the chariot of fire, they stood to view afar off. Other people are getting to the place where they're going to receive the double portion, and they're standing to view afar off. Other people are making preparation to be empowered by heaven, but they are standing to view afar off. How will those people be empowered to work for God? No. They just carry religious jargon, just go all around. Not effective for God. Standing to view afar off. Their unseriousness and faithlessness manifested in various forms. Do you want me to show you how their unseriousness and faithlessness was manifested? Number one, what they had was mere religious knowledge. They don't believe it. There was no heart belief. Somebody says, Pastor, but why do you say so? What did they say? They told Elisha, do you know the Lord will take away your master from your head today? Did they believe that God will take away Elijah that day? They didn't. Verse 16. Let's see verse 16. To tell you that what they were saying in their mouth, they didn't believe it in their heart. Verse 16. It says, and they said unto him, unto Elisha, behold, now there be with thy servants 50 strong men. Let them go with thee and seek thy master, lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord had taken him up and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley. And he said, ye shall not send. And when they watched him till he was ashamed, he said, send. They sent therefore 50 men, and they sought 3 days, but found him not. And when they came again to him, for he tarried at Jericho, he said unto them, did I not say unto you, go not? Look here. They were telling Elisha, do you know the Lord is going to take away your master from your head today? But they didn't believe it in their heart. After God had taken Elijah away and the chariot had gone, they came back to Elisha. In case God didn't fulfill his promise, in case that chariot crashed and Elijah is already in pain on one mountain or in some valley, let's go and help the prophet too. God has not taken, maybe God has not taken him home. Elijah's answer said, you shall not send. But they put pressure, and you don't know, we are caring. We don't want the prophet to be in agony and in pain until he said, okay, send. 3 days, they sent 50 people to go and comb every valley and every mountain to see the wreckage of the chariot of heaven, to be able to rescue Elijah. Then they came back, they said, I told you, God has taken him home. But they were the ones that were telling Elisha, do you know the Lord will take away your master from your head today? They don't believe it. It was just mere profession in the mouth. Their heart is not synchronized with that. And yet they were sons of the prophets. When you move with those kind of people, you say, I want to develop faith. And you are moving with those kind of people, you can never develop faith, my brother. You can never. They don't believe it. They are saying it, but their heart is not saying yes to it. It was mere religious knowledge. And you know, The Bible talks about that. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we don't want to get to that kind of a place. My brother, never get to that kind of a place where all what you know is just Bible knowledge. No heart experience. What you are saying in your mouth, you don't really believe it in your heart. You teach out the scriptures, but you don't believe it. What are you teaching? You shouldn't be there. You shouldn't be there. And there are people that will teach, say, but that's what they told me to teach. But you should teach what you believe. If you don't believe it, you have no business teaching it. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 7. It says, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. These sons of the prophets, ever learning, but they've not been able to grasp the truth even by with their heart. To know that when God says, I'm taking my Sabbath home, I'm taking my Sabbath home, the chariot never crashes. Ever learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now, as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobates concerning the truth. They were in the kingdom, they are leaders in the church, but there is something else. Something else. What they say in the mouth, they don't believe it in the heart. Just like the sons of the prophets. Number two, can you see skepticism and following afar off? If you really believe, you want to see where the prophet goes. You want to see it to the very last, but they didn't believe it. So, well, we said it, but we are not sure whether it is. They're following afar off. And there are people like that. You remember Exodus chapter 32? After Moses went to the mountaintop to go and collect direction for life's journey for the children of Israel. After he has gone, they said, even as for this Moses, we don't know what has happened to him. Whether he's going to stay on the mountain forever, he will come back, we don't know. But you, make us another God. Let him lead us back to Egypt. And then they went into idolatry. How can you forget? This was the Moses that brought you, you know, through the Red Sea. This was the Moses that effected the Exodus. You experienced the plagues in Egypt. You saw the power of God manifested. You see how God has used him to bring you to where you are. And then how can you say with your mouth, as for this Moses, we don't know what has happened to him, whether he will come or not. Let's just do what we want to do. All serious people in the kingdom, easily they forget the power of God. Easily they forget the visitation of God. Easily they forget. Viewing afar off, very detached. They don't want to be committed. Always far off. They stay far so that you don't tell them, my brother, can you help us to drop this family at home? Say, they don't want to spend fuel. Say, the fuel I have there, I've calculated it is fuel to go to work and come back from work for the next 3 days. So immediately the church finishes, papa, they've gone. Because they don't want the pastor to say, can you help us to drop this family? Always staying afar off. They don't want to be committed. Skeptics. Number three, discouraging and distracting others that are committed. Here was Elisha, committed, wanting to follow Elijah to the very end. And they are coming with their comment. Do you know the Lord is going to take away your master from your head today? So why don't you sort out yourself? Why are you going with him? This and that. They are not going to do, but they are not going to allow others also to do. Very bad. Discouraging and distracting others that are committed. I pray you will not be like that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So the first thing we see here is the faithless spirit of the unserious in these upcoming ministers. Faithless spirit. The Lord is going to take away your master from your head today, but you don't believe it. Why are you talking statements you don't believe? Why are you saying things you don't believe? Jesus is coming, but you don't believe it. We say, well, that's what the Bible says we should say. What do you believe in your heart? Faithless spirit of this or serious. Number two, we see the foolish suggestion of the unbelieving. Elisha received the mantle when Elijah went. He received the double portion. The sons of the prophets, they witnessed and acknowledged it. They said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha, because they saw that the last miracle, physical miracle they saw that Elijah did, imparting the River Jordan to go. That was the first miracle that Elisha did when he was coming back. He also parted the Red Sea, the River Jordan. And they said, if Elisha can do what Elijah did, the spirit of Elijah don't rest on Elisha. Then 50 of them, they presented themselves as strong men. Look at it in 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2 in verse... in verse 16. And they said unto him, behold, now there be with thy servants 50 strong men. Let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master, lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord hath taken him up and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley. And he said, you shall not say. Can you see that foolish suggestion? Say, in case the chariot has crashed and the spirit has not been able to fulfill the promise of God, and the prophet now is in pains because he has been abandoned on the mountain or in some valley where the chariot crashed, let's go and search. Foolish suggestion of the unbelieving. It is unbelief in your heart that makes you to think that the chariot of heaven can crash. Is it the chariot manufactured by Boeing? Is it the chariot manufactured in Russia? Is it Fiat? How can the chariot of heaven crash? You can see. Foolish suggestion. And the prophet said, don't go. You don't need to go. Elijah is in heaven. He has gone. God said he was going to take him away. He has taken him away. There is no crash. But they said, no, we must search, because there's a possibility of crash. Impossibility is always with men. God is a God of possibilities every time.
Amen.
They said, we have 50 strong, agile men capable of going to search. They are not strong in advancing the cause of the gospel. They are not strong in supporting the work of God, but they are always strong in investigating the perceived failure of the kingdom. You know, there are some believers like that. All the scandals going on in the church, they are the ones that are sending all the information on WhatsApp. Say, the choir master of that church has just raped the pastor's daughter, and they are the ones who will be sending the WhatsApp to everybody. My brother, is that the rotten information you can be promoting? Say, pastor, you know, I notify everybody, but you don't notify them of salvation. You don't notify them of sanctification. You are not strong in the work of God. We are 50 strong men, strong to distribute junk. Every kind of, you know, scandals that is going on in the church, they are the ones, they are strong. You know, they have strong network, they will distribute it. COVID-19, all the conspiracies of COVID-19, they are the one, they send the video, send it to this one, send it to that one, send it to that one. They have not sent a promise of God to anybody, but it's all these conspiracy theories that are creating fear. That's what you are sending all around. 50 strong men. I pray you will not be strong men like that, like these people, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I will be strong in propagating the gospel. Amen. Strong in supporting the work of God. Strong in lifting up the weak. Strong in helping to build faith in the people that are doubting. Strong in encouraging people to trust God and be the best for Him.
Amen.
Not strong in investigating the perceived failures of the kingdom. 50 strong men, let's go and search. We are sure that the chariot has crashed and the prophet is in pain. We want to tell you, they are strong in investigating the perceived failures of the kingdom. Anywhere things can go wrong, that's where you fit see them. Anywhere things can go right, we don't see them there. Are you like that? Any scandal in the church, you will find them there. They are not the one that caused the scandal, but they are going to spread so that everybody will know. Help us to mop up the mess. Help us to solve the problem. Help us to limit the damage. But no, instead of limiting the damage, they are going to spread the rumors and spread the thing and make sure that the whole world hears. What are you doing? Say, Pastor, I'm strong. Strong in expanding evil. Don't be like that. Don't be like that. They have no time to build themselves in their most holy faith. Time to pray, time to build themselves, like Jude said, building up yourselves in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. They don't have time for that, but they have time to go and search for the crash, for the wreck of the crash chariot. They don't have time for Bible study, but they have time to see what happened to that brother that refused to come to Bible study. My brother, why is it that, you know, your time is just wasted in things that have no value, that add no value to anybody? Like these people, they have no time to build themselves in their most holy faith, but they have time, ample time, to read all the stories of scandal happening in the church around the world. Find some brethren, they can tell you what is going on in Nigeria. You know, how this pastor raped that one, what is going on, how this one is using juju, how this one, all the stories and the scandals happening in all these fake pastors, they have it. But they cannot tell you, yesterday I had a message, a convicting message from that pastor. Let me send you one for you to hear so that we can prepare for heaven. They don't have that. But all the scandals, that's what they have. My brother, how can your WhatsApp be so full of this, just these things? And you're just helping the devil to spread useless information that does not build anybody. And that's the one. The moment they send it to you, you send it to 20 other people, send it to 30 other people. And it's all useless information that does not edify anybody. I pray the Lord Himself, He will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
They opened their mouth with very foolish suggestion. They told Elisha, let these strong men, let them go, we pray thee, and search and seek thy master. Lest our adventure, the spirit of the Lord are taking him up and cast him upon some mountain. Is the spirit of God a wicked spirit? Take you from here and go and dump you in a no man's land. These are prophets, so people studying to be What have they been studying about the Holy Ghost? What have they been taught about the Spirit of God? Look at the sentence that they are making. Do these people even understand who the Holy Ghost is? They are in school, ever learning, not able to come to the knowledge of the truth. So maybe the Spirit of the Lord are taking him up and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley. And Elisha said, you shall not sink. They were essentially saying, maybe the chariot has crashed and the prophet may be wounded and is in pains. How can the sons of the prophets, people that were being trained to be prophets, people attending the school of the prophets, how can they think like this? What kind of God have they been studying about? What kind of God have they been learning about in the school of the prophet? The chariot of heaven is not the aeroplane manufactured in the USA by Boeing, so it cannot crash. The chariot of heaven is not the helicopter that has been made in Russia, so it cannot crash. The chariot of heaven is not a car made in Japan by Toyota, so it cannot crash. The chariot of heaven is not a rocket, you know, a rocket or a space shuttle made in the USA by NASA, so it cannot crash. So how can you be saying that the chariot of heaven has crashed? Is it a mechanical device made by a man that can go faulty? This is a chariot made by God of heaven himself. And this is a student in the school of the prophets saying that. You know, can you look up? It's important for you to know who you are listening to. You know, sometimes, I don't talk much, but sometimes we need to say some things. You know, many of our members, you go on the internet, you listen to Daddy Freeze, Daddy Freeze, Daddy Freeze. Recently, Daddy Freeze said that Satan answers prayer faster than God. Is that the person you should be listening to? It's not me that said it. You can read it on the internet. He said Satan answers prayer faster than God. And then they will now come and talk about tithe, talk about this, talk about this, talk about this. And people will carry it on their head and they are moving around. Look at this also, the prophets. He's saying maybe the chariot of heaven has crashed and the prophet is in pain. So we need to go somewhere and go and rescue him. Maybe he's on the mountain or in the valley. And they went, 50 of them, they searched, combed every nook and corner, every mountain, every valley for 3 full days. To tell you what they believe, that the chariot of heaven would have crashed. And these are students in the school of the prophets. What have they been learning? What have they been learning about the God of impossibility? What have they been learning about the power of the Holy Ghost? What have they been learning about, you know, that God that says and he does what he says? They've been learning, but they are nobodies. They are not anywhere near being a real minister of God. They are far off. It's a pity for people who begin to listen to this kind of people. You will go nowhere. It's all, their unbelief will infect your will infect you. Their faithlessness will be dumped in your life. They will be saying things that look something, but everything is empty. This source of the prophets. Empty, nothing inside them. How can you be in the school of the prophets and you are acting and saying this and behaving like this? You are in the school of the prophets that you ought to know the God you are serving. You ought to know the power of God and the veracity and the faithfulness of his truth and his word. And then you'll be saying that maybe the Spirit of God has cast the prophet on a mountain or in some valley. That chariot has crashed. God has not fulfilled his promise. Maybe God forgot, you know, and then the gear didn't go right and then the chariot went. Is it a chariot made by man? How can you think like that? This is the chariot of Israel made from heaven. Everybody says chariot made from heaven.
chariot made from heaven.
The chariot made from earth is crushing. If the space shuttle made from earth crashes, this chariot made from heaven doesn't crash.
Yes, sir.
It has the stamp upon it, made in heaven. It doesn't crash. When it leaves, it arrives home. It doesn't go faulty. God looks over it. It's made in heaven. God is in control. It can never crash.
Mm.
And they saw it eventually. They looked for 3 days. 3 days of wasted effort. 3 days of wasted time. The prophet that ought to go is waiting for them. He stayed at Jericho. Let me wait until they come back. Even though I know they are not going to take to bring any news, but at least so that they will not say, even the prophet doesn't care, let me stay. Wasted the prophet's time, wasted their own effort to look for what they will never see, because the chariot never crashed. Elijah is enjoying himself in heaven. They are busy looking for his wreckage on earth. Stupid, foolish people. And it will surprise you that sometimes some people are in leadership and their actions and what they say is stupid and foolish. And they don't know. It's contrary to scripture. It's so carnal. And when you have a lot of those kind of people in the church doesn't move forward. That local church will be crippled. Will be crippled. Because their combined unbelief and their faithlessness will just cripple the church. The church wants to move forward. All their suggestions are, no, there's no need. Let's just stay here. The church cannot move forward. So what do we see there? We see the foolish suggestion of the unbelieving. And people with unbelief in their heart, people that doubts are in their heart, their suggestions will always be very foolish. I can tell you that. Their suggestions will always be very foolish. When God tells Elijah, go to the house of the widow of Zarephath, he will take care of you. The moment they get there, if they accompany the prophet, and the woman says, your handmaid has nothing in the house, except a little flour and a pot of oil. And I'm just gathering 2 pieces of firewood to cook it so that my son will eat part and I will eat part, and they will be waiting for. They are the first people to go to the news broadcasters. Our prophet said, God said, that this woman that can't even feed herself will feed our prophet. We don't know where this Holy Ghost is moving our prophet. You know, they cannot believe God. They just act in a carnal way. God has spoken and he can fulfill his promise. If he needs to multiply that oil, he will multiply the oil. If he needs to multiply the bread, the flour, he will multiply the flour and fulfill his word. That woman will take care of you, and the woman took care of him. We need people that will believe God. We don't need faithless, no upcoming ministers. We want to move and God is taking the church to a place. We don't need people to come and be pouring cold water because they can't even move themselves, not to talk about moving other people. We don't want people like that. We don't want people like that in leadership. If you say we're going to plant a church, they have 1,000 reasons why the church cannot stand. They don't see souls that are perishing. No, they don't see the work of God that needs to be done. Any suggestion you make, we are going to move, they have a counter suggestion why we cannot move. Never excited about things. They just want to stay cool, detached, viewing afar off. And when the church is full of leaders like that, that church is dead. That church will never do anything significant for God. Fill the church with this kind of source of the prophets. They are not interested in crusade. They're interested, okay, let's just go and see our brother that has cancer and just encourage him because he will soon die. Tell them we are going to fast and pray and believe God for healing for the brother. They don't have time for that. They are not for that. Say, Pastor, let's just patch him up and just encourage him. Another 3 days, he will be gone. They're not ready to fast. They're not ready to pray. They're not ready for breakthrough. They're just there in the church. Everything is cold. And I pray that you will not be part of that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You will not be a pastor like that. Sometimes maybe there is a challenge. I will say, well, you know, we need to do this, and the church does not have enough money, but later we'll be able to, we need to raise some money. It's a pastor that will say, brethren, we complain. You already are complaining. So how would the brethren not complain? We need to be positive. This is the work of God. How much can you buy salvation? What are you going to give in exchange for your soul? Even if you give God £1 million, is it enough to even thank him for the salvation of your soul? How much are we asking for, brethren? Lend us €500. We will give you back in 2 months' time. The brethren will complain. Do we understand the salvation that we have? Do we know the sacrifice of Calvary? And sometimes pastors that are going to, they've not gone to the congregation, no. They are the ones that are first of all going to tell you, brethren, we complain. Brethren, we complain. No wonder the work is not going on. If you look at us by the grace of God in Lazio region, we don't say that. We just believe God and we just move on. We wanted to pay some things, this or that. Somebody gave us €1,000 loan, and that person gave us €500 loan. You know, this and that, we get the job done. By God's grace, September, we pay them back the money. The job would have been done. The Lord has been glorified, and their money is returned. Two individuals, €1,000, €500. You are asking, brethren, lend us €50, lend us €100. This is the work of God. Nobody is eating it. When we have people like Elisha, things get done. We receive the double portion. River Jordan will break. I mean, we'll part open. Things will move. But when you have a lot of sons of the prophets in the church, there's disaster. We are going nowhere. I'm telling you, we are going nowhere. It will be discussion upon discussion. They will say, Pastor, let us set up committee. You set up the committee. At the end of the day, what is going to come out of the committee? The committee will just say that we discussed 2 hours yesterday, we discussed 3 hours, a day before yesterday. Our conclusion is that it cannot be done. Just wasted time, wasted effort. I pray your local church will not be full of those kind of people in Jesus.
Amen.
You better pray that God will send you the type of Elisha. Amen. Those are the people you need.
Jesus.
In your local church, if that local church is going to move, you need people like Elisha. You don't need people like the sons of the prophets. You need people like Elisha. You know, I remember the time when we were to start the church in Grosseto. And I told our brother and our sister, and I said, well, you're going to help us to drive. And you know what? They will start at home around 5:30 a.m. They kick the church bus. It takes 4 hours. As they're going along the way, they pick this individual, they go to, you know, Siena, they pick another individual, they go to Grosseto, they pick the people, then they go to Pisa. 4 hours. When we finish church, they drop all those people, and then they are going to try it again. It takes another 4 hours. Sometimes they are coming back home midnight, and they do it every Sunday. That's how that church has been established. You tell some brothers, say, Pastor, by the time I drop everybody, church has finished at 12. I will be getting 1:30. It's 2 months. We don't need those kind of people, though. We can't sacrifice. They can't see the sacrifice of Calvary for them. Well, you know, this couple, they will leave home 5 a.m., 5:30 a.m. to already. It means that they have already woken up before them, bathed and cooked. They leave home. At least there was a day I was with them. We left home like that to go together. And they're not going to come back home until midnight. How will the work not be done? This is the kind of commitment you need. These are the kind of people you need in the church, not the one that help us to go and drop brother A. You say, well, I will be late. I mean, it means that 5 minutes will be added onto my time. Well, you better pray that God will give you Elishas in your church.
Amen.
And that God will help the sons of the prophets to move to another congregation.
Amen.
If they will not change, I don't want them. If they will not change. Do you know when you have 5 people like Elisha in a church, you move that church.
Yes, sir.
You have 100 like the sons of the prophets. You are going nowhere. It's not the number. It's not the number. You are talking about if you have 5 like Elisha, there will be revival.
Amen.
You have 100 like the sons of the prophets. You cannot even kindle any fire. Faithless spirit of the unserious, foolish suggestion of the unbelieving. Say that. Fruitless search of the unconvinced. The prophet told them he will not go. But they put pressure, they brought this argument, they brought that argument, they brought that argument until the prophet said, all right, please yourself, go and search. And they were so happy. Back, 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 back. They distributed themselves. Many search parties, 3 full days searching for what should not be searched for, searching for record they can never find. 3 days. And after 3 days, they now came back and told Elijah, we didn't find anything. I told you, don't go. Fruitless search of the unconvinced. And let me tell you, when you find somebody who is following Jesus and is unconvinced, you'll be expending your energy in what you should not be expending your energy. It's good, and the searches will produce no result because God's chariot does not crash. So the wreckage of the chariot you are looking for, you will never find. It will always be the fruitless search. Elisha told them the search was not necessary. He said, don't go. However, these people were not convinced. And they put so much pressure on Elisha until he uttered the search. And the Bible says, and when they urged him till he was ashamed, they put so much pressure until the prophet asked, just say, okay, please yourself. Okay, please yourself. Search. They sent therefore 50 men, and they sought 3 days, but found him not. And when they came again to him, for he tarried at Jericho, Elisha should have gone. But he said, if I go as a leader, it will seem as if I don't care. At least let them come back with safety, then I can go. 3 days of his time wasted in Jericho, waiting for them. He knows that the search is going to be fruitless, but they are wasting his time that he could use for other things. He tarried at Jericho. Then he said unto them, did I not say unto you, go not? You have pleased yourself. But I know that this is going to be the result. I told you before. That's what Elisha said. Their 3-day search was a fruitless search, a waste of time, a waste of energy, a waste of other resources. Unbelieving and unconvinced ministers always lead the church along the path of useless and worthless projects. They will suggest, we carry out research and explore various unscriptural possibilities. Well, it may be that, you know, like people are saying in the world, homosexuality, maybe it has a genetic origin. Homosexuality is sin. There's no genetic origin. We are not going to waste any money on doing one biological research. It has no genetic origin. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Those are the prophets. That's the kind of suggestion they're going to be making. Let the church put some money together and put some research people together and let them investigate, maybe do research into the genetic origin of homosexuality. What are you going to find? It's just going to be a waste of resources, a waste of time, a waste of intellectual effort, because later you will find out that homosexuality has no genetic origin. Homosexuality is sin. It's sexual perversion. There are the people that are going to tell you, even though we say that Jesus is the only way to heaven, but what's happening to all these other people that are not believers? Maybe we can work together. We are serving the same God. Let's interfaith. You know, they are always like that. The possibility of interfaith worship and the religious polarity. They are always making all those kind of useless suggestions. There's no conviction of the faith that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. That there is no other name given among men whereby we can be saved except the name of Jesus. They are not convinced. Their faith is not that strong. So they are looking for how to unify every religion. Buddhism and Islam and Baha'i faith and the Armstrongianism and the, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons and then and the Christians, put everything together and give us concussion. Always. Those are the sons of the prophets. And it's always going to be a fruitless search. Because after you have done your research and everything, what are you going to come out with? Because there is no substance in it. It's just going to be a lot of waste of effort, waste of time, waste of resources. They have no time to study the scriptures and contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints. But they are so secular minded and they think like unbelievers. They live on the level of physical senses. They have no spiritual desire. No spiritual sensibilities. While they were busy searching for the fragments of the crashed chariot, the prophet Elijah was already home, enjoying the desired rest in the bosom of the Father. The prophet they are looking for is enjoying his rest. These ones are wasting their time looking for a prophet they will never find because the guy is home already, resting in the bosom of the Father. Useless search, fruitless search. Rather than these ministers writing hymns to the praise of a never-failing God, they were busy composing songs to explore the possibility of divine failure. That's the kind of thing. Let's go and search. Maybe the chariot crashed. Instead of writing hymns and say, we thank God, a God of possibility, a God of all wonders, a God that when he sends a chariot, the chariot goes home, it never crashes. They need to be writing those kind of songs, but they are writing the song, we never can tell, even chariot from heaven can crash. That's the kind of song they are writing. The chariot of heaven crashing, anathema, God forbid. Faithful is he who has promised and who also will fulfill it. When he says, I'm taking Elijah home in a whirlwind by a chariot of fire, he's taking Elijah home in a whirlwind by a chariot of fire. He never fails. His promises are here and amen. His word is ever, is dependable. Don't spend your time doing fruitless searches. Whatever God has said is able to perform. Don't be like this. So can you see these people? Faithlessness in upcoming ministers. These were the people that were, where is Israel going? With this kind of source of the prophets in the school of the prophets, after Elijah goes and these ones take over, the nation is destroyed. Can these ones minister healing? Can these ones minister, you know, real possibilities to the people? No, they are so secular minded that, you know, they have no stuff to offer the nation. That nation is destroyed. And when we have ministers in our church also that are in this mode, coming in this mode, what is the faith of the next generation? What is the faith of the next generation in the church? Nothing. But I pray that you will not be a minister like this.
Amen.
That this faithlessness in this source of the prophets will not be your portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That this faithless spirit of the unserious will not infect you. That this foolish suggestion of the unserious will not be your mode of action in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The foolish search of the unconvinced will not be, you know, you just wasting time and wasting effort and wasting this, you know. And this is a lot. You find in the church today that the church is doing so much research. When they have conferences, Methodist Church will have a conference and they will establish a committee and then they'll say, let's look into whether women should be ordained in the ministry and co. They spend a lot of money to research and co and co. By the time they come out, what are we coming out? A lot of conference, a lot of research, research. Let's go into the scriptures and implement what God has said. Say, no, you know, the world is changing. We need to do this. We need to do this. And the church is so busy doing a lot of all those researches. Sinners are dying and going to hell. Nobody to evangelize them. Nobody to go after them. And the church is so busy expending money, expending resources, expending time, doing useless researches, fruitless searches. They want to search whether if somebody is in a homosexual relationship, he can get to heaven. My brother, you don't need to waste time to do that research. He is not going to go to heaven unless the homosexual repents, abandons sin. The gate of heaven will not open. We don't need research for that. But we spend a lot of money and then we're looking at the sociology of it and the psychology of it and the mechanics of it and the maybe tomorrow they will look at the engineering of it. What is wrong with the church? But by the grace of God, the Lord is going to help us.
Amen.
And you need to examine your own life as a minister in this church. Are you like Elisha? Or are you like one of the sons of the prophets? Are you viewing afar off? Are you close to Elijah? Are you focused on the double portion? Are you looking for Christ's chariot? Do you believe God is going to keep his word and take his prophet home? Or are you doubting that, well, that's what they say, but we are not sure it will happen? What kind of a person are you? What kind of a leader are you? Because that is going to impact the church. How the church will be is how you are, like the priest, like the people. But tonight, we're going to tell God that every form of faithlessness in us, every form of, you know, unseriousness in our life, every form of unbelief resident in our life, every form of not fully persuaded, not being convinced that God will remove it. We want to be like Elisha, focused, steadfast, committed, moving on, and he will receive double portion and he will do exploits in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and pray and tell the Lord that tonight I want to be an Elisha. I don't want to be like one of the sons of the prophets. All kinds of unseriousness, all kinds of not being convinced, all kinds of unbelief. Oh God, take it away from my life. I want your fire. I want the double portion. I want to
be like Elisha, oh Lord.
I want to be
a double portion.
I want to be fully persuaded in the name of
Lord. I want to be fully persuaded.
You are an upcoming minister. But what kind of upcoming minister are you? Upcoming minister like Elisha, or upcoming minister like one of the sons of the prophets? What kind are you? What kind are you? They are all upcoming ministers.
Lord, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus.
That God will help you not to be like the sons of the prophet. You want to be like Elisha, focused, committed, consecrated, you know, seeking and searching for the double portion. Don't be involved with fruitless search. Don't be involved with foolish suggestion. Don't be involved with the faithless spirit. And the Lord himself is going to do it.
Lord, help me, Lord. Let me mighty and everlasting Father.